morning. If this is not where you are normally on Sunday morning, then welcome. If this is where you normally are on Sunday morning, you're equally welcome. Would you join with me in the responses as we call ourselves to worship and worship our God? Even if we can't gather in person, imagine God with us. Even if some Christmas traditions have had to go, imagine God with us. Even if we might not get to have family and friends, imagine God with us. Even if we cannot sing carols beside each other, God with us. Even if Christmas cheer is handled this year, imagine God with us. So in that vein, let us hum together the first hymn, The Race That Longed in Darkness Pined.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This third week of Advent, let us remember that the good news of Jesus' birth has the power to bring us great joy this Christmas season. Our joy isn't dependent on what is going on in our life or in our world or for the people we are with. It doesn't depend on the gifts we give or the gifts we find under the tree. No earthly thing can ever give us complete joy. Our joy comes from the Lord. That joy that flooded the hearts of the shepherds, the angels, the wise men, the hosts of heaven. And of course, it flooded the hearts of Mary and Joseph. The joy that still has the power to overwhelm our hearts with rejoicing. Those who gathered round the new baby were blessed because they believed that had fulfilled your promises. Mary and Joseph believed and were able to feel the joy of holding baby Jesus in their arms. The shepherds and the wise men believed the angels and the signs, and they experienced great gladness in worshipping their Messiah. Those who knew him and recognized him were overjoyed at the coming of Jesus. They saw the prophecies fulfilled, and their fear was replaced with happiness as they gazed on the face of the one who would be their Saviour. They trusted in the promises of the Lord, and their hearts were filled with gladness as they watched his loving kindness manifested in the face of a tiny baby in a lowly manger. Lord, you offer us that same joy now if we know you and recognize Jesus as our Saviour and Lord. The Lord gives us a reason to celebrate when he gives us the unspeakable gift of Jesus Christ. He came to dwell among us. He went to Calvary's cross for us. He overcame death and rose from death for us. He forgives our sins and gives us life eternal when we believe in him. And so, as we use the Advent carol to hum and remind us of the gifts we have been given, we'll light our candles at the same time. So let us hum together verses 1, 2, and 3 of Hope is a Candle.
Thank you.
the word of God.
Today's lessons are taken from the Gospel of Luke, both from chapter 1. The first passage starts at verse 26 and it is headed, "The Birth of Jesus Foretold." In the sixth month, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored, the Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will be a child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be barren is in her sixth month. For nothing is impossible with God." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May it be to me as you have said." Then the angel left her. The second passage starts at verse 46 and is called Mary's song. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior. For he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed. For the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. His mercy extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm, and he has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. He has brought down the rulers from their thrones and has lifted up the humble. He has filled the hungry with good things and has sent the rich away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he said to our fathers." Here ends the lesson.
Thank you for that. Let us pray. Lord, we are your people who have journeyed in darkness and who long to see your light once more. We are those who have journeyed through hard times and who long to see life and community renewed. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we give thanks for scientists and researchers and for those who have created the vaccines that give hope to the world. We pray for the just sharing of these precious gifts and for the renewal of life in every nation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we are those who journey
We journey in times when we are distanced, and trust that in time the distance shall be overcome. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we are those who have heard of the true light that is coming into the world. We ask that we might become your messengers and bear witness to Jesus Christ, the light of God that is to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Amen. So very appropriately for this Sunday and our readings, let us listen to the hymn, "The Angel Gabriel from Heaven Came."
Remember when this story was first written and first told,
A time when women were merely footnotes in the history of men's actions on the world. So Luke gives us a radical telling of the birth of Christ, one that effectively sidelines men and focuses on Mary and her cousin Elizabeth. It is their perspectives we hear, their songs of joy we sing. Women had made occasional appearances in biblical history. Deborah was one of the great judges in Israel's early history, and the story of Ruth and her devotion to her mother-in-law are notable examples. But mostly, women either didn't figure at all, or they were characterized as seductresses or schemers. Think of Jezebel. Think of some of the other great characters we have, where women make an appearance in the Bible, but never in a positive light. Here, though, they are recognized by God as the means by which the world can be changed and saved. And they would do so by the most ordinary means possible, through the birth of a child. Ordinary, and yet so extraordinary. Anyone who's ever been present at the birth of a child knows what an extraordinary event it is to witness. But of course, I defer to those of you who have given birth to have your new experience. Pregnancy and childbirth in the ancient world were fraught with difficulty. And even today, women still face risks in pregnancy. But that was nothing compared to the risks faced 2,000 years ago. Pregnancy would mean meeting with conflicting emotions for the woman, the joy and the thought of becoming a mother, but also the fear of the pain and the possibility of not making it through the labour. Add to that the knowledge that at least one in five children wouldn't see their first birthday. As well as Mary's youth, she was probably still a teenager herself. And you can see why Mary is sceptical at the beginning, why Mary hesitates. It's understandable that she'd take a deep gulp and go, "Really? Really?" But Mary accepts God's message. And that, in so many ways, is even more remarkable. Mary is the true star of our story. As a poor girl growing up in a very conservative society, Mary would have expected her life to follow all the usual patterns. Marriage to an older man who would bring her security, bringing up a family that would look after her in her old age, and the daily grind of cooking, cleaning, serving the needs of those around her. There would be little time for Mary to be herself. The women of the first century really rested and were really recognized for their contribution to society. Luke's gospel changes all of that. Mary and Elizabeth come to the fore. Their story is told in greater detail than it ever had been. And they are seen as three-dimensional characters rather than passive subjects of some other tale. Firstly, we have Elizabeth, an older woman who had never had children, and all of a sudden she discovers she's pregnant. It has echoes of the story of Abraham and Sarah, those great ancestors of the Israelites. Then Mary is told of God's plan through her angelic visitation. And she'd be forgiven for thinking she'd eaten something funny or was having a hallucination. But she hears God's message and accepts the role she will play in the redemption story. She has a moment of hesitation. Who wouldn't? How is she going to explain all this to her husband. But once she understands, she is to be the means by which God will change history. She expresses the joy of the mother-to-be. God also comes to the fore as the other character in this story through his agent Gabriel. The Israelites have been through many troubles over the previous four centuries and have feared that God had left them completely. Their prayers and worship in the temple seemed to have gone unheard and unanswered. They were overrun first by the Greeks and then by the Romans. Now God makes a dramatic return to the history of his people. But his people are yet to recognize what happened or its significance for the world. Today we celebrate the joy of motherhood, of the birth of a child. But we do more than that. We celebrate God's return to his people and his intervention in our world. And that is also a joyful moment, a time when we can start to move forward with hope rather than backwards with fear. It was true of the world 2,000 years ago, and it is just as true today. Now we have the prospect of a vaccine that will allow us to start a return to some form of normality. It will take time for that normality to return, and we will have to be patient. But we can begin to take baby steps, just like that first Christmas. Change won't happen overnight, but change will come. And one day soon, we will reap the rewards of all the efforts so many have made, as well as all their sacrifices. God knew it would take time to change hearts. Christmas was the beginning of the story. Story that crosses time and space, as well as changing the course of history. It all began with a woman called Mary and her willingness to give life to a child who would go on to make history. Amen. May God add his blessing to these words. I have a small postscript to this story, because as I was sitting writing this last night, Liz was getting text messages about our nephew's partner in Ireland, who has been in and out of the hospital for the last fortnight, at the last stages of her pregnancy. And literally, as I was writing about the risks of pregnancy, we were getting messages saying, she's back in hospital. We're hoping this time the baby will be born. So in your thoughts and prayers, keep Shannon in there, because we know that even today, women face huge risks in pregnancy and in childbirth. Here in the 21st century, it shouldn't be that hard, should it? And yet somehow it still is. Just a personal postscript. Let us come together in our prayers for the world and our prayers of dedication. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we bring before you our gifts. Gifts of money and gifts of ourselves. We pray that you put the money we give and our service to good use in this church, in our community, and in the world. I mean, we think we have little to offer, but we have so much to give. Our love and our joy at your intervention, and the hope we carry for a better world in the future. Eternal light, shine in our hearts, that our days may be bright with your presence. May we be aware of the great things you have done for us and rejoice in your salvation. We remember all who walk in darkness and do not know the love of God. We remember those who have never heard the good news. We pray that the whole church may reach out in mission, in service, and in love. We pray especially for the church, whether it has lost vision or sense of outreach. Eternal light, shine in our hearts. Remember our world where people are oppressed, where there is hunger and poverty. We ask you to strengthen all who work for peace and to relieve the poor. This time we pray especially for all those in our communities who go hungry for the lack of cheap food and who go thirsty for the lack of care. May we do all that we can to be of help to them. We give you thanks for our homes and our loved ones, for the freedom and the peace that is ours. May we be sensitive to the needs of those around us and be of help where we can. God gives strength and courage to all who are ill, to those involved in accidents or acts of violence. We remember those who have lost their freedom or their homes. We give thanks to all who work in hospitals and for our own doctors and nurses in community practices around the country. And now, in the silence of our hearts, Lord, we bring before you those we know of in need of your care, your comfort, and your compassion. Eternal light, shine in our hearts. We rejoice that you have freed us from the slavery of sin and death and brought us to the glorious liberty of the children of God. We rejoice in the gift of eternal life and pray for friends and loved ones departed. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour and Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen. We have heard the song read to us. Now let us hear it in musical form. Tell out, my soul, the greatness of the Lord. Mary's song of joy and of love.
Thank you.
know how blessed you are, and go to be that blessing to all around you. May God Almighty hold you and all who you love in the palm of his hand this day and always. Amen. Thank you.